Hi, this is Steve Michelotti from the Azure Government Engineering team. I'm joined here today by Sachin Dubey, my colleague, also from the Azure Government Engineering team. Welcome, Sachin.
Thank you, Steve. Glad to be back.
So we're today going to talk about MySQL on Azure Government. So we should probably start out by talking about, you know, we already have a bunch of database technologies on Azure Government, SQL Server, and these type of technologies. Why do we care about MySQL?
This is one of the very old one, and still a lot of people are using it. It's very powerful, very popular. A lot of large-scale websites are using MySQL as their backend data store. Today, every single application has data and growing that. And this is one of the easiest way to set up, simple to use, reliable data, relational database management system, which is open source. A lot of people these days liking open source more and more. So we thought of talking about it today.
So MySQL has been around for a long time.
Absolutely.
It has a community where it's beloved by this community. And certainly we embrace all these open source technologies on Azure.
Absolutely. So moving on here, little bit, why MySQL? We mentioned a few things here. Easy to use, reliable, simple. I mean, if you're watching this video, you know what MySQL is.
Right. So we've had this instance where MySQL has been popular with open source communities, certainly, but lately we've seen a lot of popularity in enterprises and government agencies also.
Absolutely. Since we are trying to bring more openness to the way we code stuff.
Right.
Large diversity in terms of developers. People have various viewpoints for technology to be used and such. And this is where this becomes a little more common for enterprises also to go after some of these things that many people already using and are familiar with. And MySQL is one of those. When we talk about MySQL for enterprise applications, this is where some of these line items becomes very, very critical. Because if you're running a mission-critical application, the data store for it has to be highly available. It has to be secure, scalable. So when the new users come in, the traffic starts growing, you should be able to scale up easily. Backup and restore becomes super critical for BCDR if your data is not reproducible. And monitoring, alerting to top of everything. If you cannot monitor and alert properly, you won't be able to monitor, you won't be able to make your application available and scale efficiently. And compliance, since we're talking about Azure Government, compliance is one key pillar of it. Anything that we run on Azure Government or for government agencies and customers, compliance is a key piece of it. So anytime you talk about open source systems for writing your code or for storing your information, make sure that is also a checkbox, the compliance piece.
So that's an interesting list. I mean, it's one thing for developers like us to use MySQL because we know how easy it is to enable us to run queries and interact with data. But some of this is getting more complex. It's really more enterprise focused. And I don't know, it's one thing for it to be easy for a developer, but this looks more complicated now.
That is true. These line items are not alien. Most people are familiar with these. But these single items, when you start addressing these, they become a laundry list of items that you need to take care of. Each one of these items have costs associated with them, the training of personnel, and also efforts associated with them. Your application, the type of application, how large it is, who your customers are gonna determine what these items gonna cost you in terms of the effort. That being said, we cannot discount these. Even if a simple application that's serving a lot of users, no compliance or additional security is required, you still have to make sure it's available because users not going to come back to your website if it's down even for minutes in some scenarios. So that said, these are important. And we talked about why people like MySQL. It's easy to install, configure, it's simple to use. But these things will put extra burden on your IT department to be able to comply and for your enterprise application. So how do we solve this thing? Not every single small team has resources to checkbox all these items. And this is where Azure comes to rescue.
Okay.
If you are running on Azure, if you are using it as your infrastructure to run your application, another addition to that is Azure Database for MySQL.
Okay, so it's one thing for me to just spin up a VM and install MySQL on the VM and I'm gonna use this. But what you're talking about here is Azure Database for MySQL, which you can see right here is a fully managed PaaS service.
Absolutely. This is fully managed by Azure, the platform as a service offering. which takes away all those maintenance and installation activities from you. You simply generate one command or go to the portal, create your database, and go after using it. You do not have to worry about instantiating a new VM, downloading the bits for MySQL, installing them, configuring them, and continue to configure based on your application as it grows.
I don't have to worry about patching the operating system that the MySQL is running on. Microsoft's just going to handle that for me.
Every single benefit of using platform as a service.
Okay, great.
Security is backed by Azure. It's available in all of our data centers. 5 Azure Government data centers you can use wherever your application is deployed. Very simple and flexible pricing. This is a key item. You'll be transparently knowing how much your database is costing you. And you can scale up, scale down based on the need. So you start something simple, small. If your application starts growing, you grow the database side and pay for it.
And what's also interesting, I heard you talk about replication in there. So again, I'm just likening it back to the scenario where I, as an individual person, spun up a VM and installed MySQL on it, but that didn't necessarily give me automatic replication to other data centers 500 miles away. But you're saying with Azure Database, you do get that type of functionality.
One click. And you're right. When we talk about availability, there are multiple layers to it. I mean, you have talk about local availability across the geographies, and this is all taken care of you. So if your application needs to replicate data across multiple miles for disaster scenarios, then you simply click one button and you have it configured. Wide support for languages and framework, this continues. Whatever support programming languages and frameworks you were using previously, you'll continue to use those. There is no changes in how you interact and use MySQL on Azure.
So talk about scaling and cost a little bit more. So this is really important. Again, I keep going back to that example of the VM. If I realize that the VM I installed it on isn't good enough, I'm out of luck. But now when I use something like Azure Database, it's a managed service. How does the scaling work? How can I control my costs?
So we will go into a little bit on that in our demo, and I'll show you exactly how you can tweak some of the information configurations on the portal and change your costing, and it's going to show you how much. So we're going to touch base on that.
Okay, great.
Integrated monitoring and alerting. So it integrates with Azure Monitor, which is a central system for monitoring and alerting. So every single resource on Azure that you monitor using Azure Monitor, this is just one piece of that.
So it's the first-class citizen on Azure.
Exactly. Automatic backups. You can configure up to 35 days of backup and make sure your data is being backed up automatically. Point-in-time recovery. You can recover. If someone goes and deletes the database, you can recover it back without having to create your own disks and backup mechanism and doing all those things that traditionally applications and MySQL is specifically running on IIS has to do.
Cool.
We talked about geo redundancy for BCDR and compliance, of course. It's running on Azure Governance to get all the benefits of compliance. So let's jump onto the demo and talk about some of these things we were just mentioning about.
All right, sounds good. Let's do it.
Here I am on my command prompt. This is one of the most efficient way for me to connect to Azure and interact with Azure resources, create, modify if I needed to delete sometime. I'm already logged in, so I'm simply going to show some details of my account.
So we see the environment name is Azure US Government, just proving you're logged in to Azure.
Absolutely. This is my subscription and information about it. What I'm going to do next is issue a simple command to create a new MySQL database server on Azure Government. Now, just passing on some basic information. There is a resource group there, name of the server, location where I want it to be, admin user account, and password.
Don't do recommended password. Password? Like okay.
Don't do passwords like this. This is just for this exercise here.
We'll take some demo liberties here.
Absolutely.
All right.
SKU name, this is where we define the size of our database server. So I'm choosing general purpose, generation 5, and 2 cores on it. And we go into the portal and we'll see how we can change that as we go and scale. There are 2 versions currently supported, 5.6 and 5.7. I'm choosing 5.7. And geo redundant backups, we talked about that this is for BCDR. The backups are going to be automatically stored in a remote location in case the primary data center experiences a lengthy outage.
Okay, sounds good.
Well, this is doing, I'm not going to lie, this takes 2-3 minutes sometimes. So we're going to go directly back to our portal, and I'm going to show you what I have pre-created. And this should be done.
Look at a database you already have provisioned.
Absolutely.
Okay.
So here is my database server, some basic information about the database server. Server name, admin name, performance configurations and such that we set while creating the database server.
All right, and these credentials can help us connect if we're using an external tool to connect or something like that.
Right. Now I'm going to go back to my MySQL client. This is running on Ubuntu Linux, and I'm going to connect with the database server that we created.
So this time you're not running the Azure CLI, you're running the MySQL CLI.
Good point. I just wanted to prove how easy it is to use several ways to interact with Azure. This is one of those several ways. If you are familiar with CLI, use that. If you're running Linux, go after that.
Awesome.
Typing in the password. There we are, connected to it. Running some simple commands. Saying database, I'm gonna go ahead and try to run some pre-configured command just to demonstrate how easy it is for us to interact.
So got my database.
Database got created. Why don't we go ahead and use the database? Let's create a table in it.
All right, so you created a table called inventory with a couple of columns.
Yep.
Looks like you have some insert statements coming here.
Right, and now we can run some select commands against. There we are.
Great, okay.
Now you can integrate this with your application. If you already have an application that's using MySQL on-prem or elsewhere and running on IIS, it's very easy to migrate. There are tools available to do the data migration if needed. Very easy to go after it.
Awesome.
Now, what we're going to do is go back to the portal and look at some of the properties and settings we talked about earlier. How do we do high availability? How we do geo redundancy? How do we secure our database server here? Starting with connection security. By default, our database server is behind a firewall. No one can connect it. I could connect it because I have my IP whitelisted. So it's secure. Even someone gets your name of the database server, they won't be able to connect unless you explicitly come in as an administrator and allow them to connect. You can also very easily change the configuration to have all the Azure services connected if that's what you desire. VNet rules. This allows you to wrap your database server behind a virtual network. So if you have a virtual network where all your resources for an application are running, you put this behind it. All the resources inside the VNet can access it. You control access using the firewall or network security groups, any one of those appliances you are using.
So that might be for like a private intranet application, for example.
Right. When we talk about compliance, these things all come into those conversations. You don't want to have people who do not interact with your application having access to these things, so you can control this, who have access to and what. And all these things are being audited and logged automatically with the monitoring integration we talked about, so you know who is interacting, who is opening ports and such activities.
Great.
SSL setting is by default enabled, but you can disable it if you so desire.
Don't do that in production.
Don't do it. Connection strings. We talked about general frameworks and languages that can be used by your application to connect to MySQL. Nothing changes here. It's the same old MySQL, just running on Azure with all the benefits of platform as a service. These are the sample connection strings. Just copy and paste, put in your code, and good to go.
Okay, great.
Server properties. If you are running MySQL or have configured MySQL on-prem, you know how to do the settings. These normally go in a config file. You dump it on the server and make sure that they are replicated across all your servers and such. Here, simple, go to portal, change the settings if you needed to. If you have multiple database servers running, script it out, run it against all the database servers. Very easy to control the server load properties.
But it is nice we can customize this stuff, and it's so easy to do in the portal, or as you said, if I don't want to use the portal, I can script it.
True, and this is critical because many people, when start using PaaS services, they worry about losing the control and customizes and capabilities, so kind of stick to that. If your application is already used to a certain number of connections per second or such, go ahead and make those settings so your application continues to work. Pricing and tiers. This is where we were talking about, Steve, earlier. How do we control the cost of our database server, scale up and scale down? Right now, you can see I started with simple 2 cores. I can easily change the setting to 4 cores and save it, and suddenly I have a more powerful database server serving my databases. And the cost is reflected here. You can easily track it and like, hey, this is how much it's going to cost. You can send it to your business and estimate it. Just makes it easier. This information also goes back to the central cost management system of Azure, so you can visualize this from your portal and select how much my databases are costing.
Great, that makes it easy.
Right. And there is the setting for geo redundancy options. This can only be set when you create the database because it creates resources in different locations. So you can only do it once. But here also you can change your retention policy for backups and for point in time recovery. And
all right, makes sense.
Some other properties, you can automate the script. Like I had my own script, but this is general for every single Azure resource. You can do the automation. We talked about monitoring and alerting. I don't want to change that. Go to the metrics. You can monitor all the vital signs of your database, the IOs, CPU, how it is doing, the number of requests per second, and all those things. And based on that, you can further customize and make it more performant for your applications.
So that's the integration with Azure Monitor that you mentioned. You can customize what you want your alerts to be, who gets emails and when, and that sort of thing. Great.
Alerting, this is where you can use the same information in your metrics. CPU utilization goes above certain threshold. You want to get alerted, notified, SMS. All those capabilities that we discussed in Azure Monitors, they all apply here.
Okay, great.
So if you're already using Azure resources and managing them, this is very simple to just add this one item in there. Server logs. Right now, my database is luckily not being used that much.
Yeah,
but you will see the logs. If you have to ever go and troubleshoot certain things, you can look for that information. So this is all the simple visualization around those properties and such. All these are accessible and manageable via the command lines, APIs, and such. You don't have to come to the portal for doing all these activities if you don't want to do it, if you have multiple databases. Scripted, automated. But one last thing I want to discuss was the point-in-time recovery. We mentioned a couple of times how do we do the backup and how we restore. This is very simple. Click on restore. You can choose your restore points, and it's as simple as that.
Okay, so when you're doing your backups, they are, each time you're doing it, creating a restore point, and you can come in and back up from any of the restore. You don't need to really care about how it's being stored. Azure's managing all that for you behind the scenes on your behalf.
Right.
All right, cool. All right, well, this has been a whirlwind tour of Azure Database for MySQL on Azure Government. Lots of great features for developers as well as management features for IT pros. This has been Steve Michelotti with Sachin Dubey from the Azure Government Engineering team talking about MySQL on Azure Government. Thanks for watching.